This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
You know, if you're like me, your heart kind of thrills to the idea of the cavalry riding to the rescue. The knight in shining armor on his white steed, the cowboy on his faithful mount coming to do the bad guys in. Hi, everybody, Rick Lamb here for the Horse Show. Well, believe it or not, that still happens in, of all places, Los Angeles County. Huge metropolitan area here in the country. We're going to meet three gentlemen who do it every single day. Hill Goedhart, Frank Bausmith, and Pedro Echeverria. They are part of the Mounted Enforcement Detail of the Parks Department of the L.A. County Sheriffs, and they are making some of these parks, these beautiful natural areas in this major metropolitan area, safe for families to use again, and they're doing it with horses. Towards the end of the show, you're going to meet award-winning equestrian architect John Blackburn. I caught up with him in Virginia. He wrote a book called Healthy Stables by Design, and he is a proponent of natural light and ventilation as a way of promoting the health of horses that are kept in barns. We're going to talk all about that. You might have seen the TV show that we did on this. This is a lot of the extra material that we could not include on the TV show. And you can also see some of the stuff that he has done by watching that show on YouTube as well. We're going to wrap things up today with Pat Cassidy of ADM Alliance Nutrition with another episode of Forage First Nutrition. He's going to talk today about which parts of your horse's diet are the most calorie dense and the least calorie dense, and how you can use this information to make your horse's diet as healthy as possible. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM Premium Horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar Bar A Horse Drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you again from Horse Expo Pomona, Pomona, California. Beautiful day here. We snuck out of the expo floor because it was just so noisy. So many people here, so much going on, lots of music. And I've got three pretty tough-looking hombres here. I would hate to see them coming down the street toward me, especially if I was a bad guy. But since I'm not a bad guy, I don't have to worry about that. They are from the Parks Department of the LA County Sheriff's Department. These guys are part of the Mounted Enforcement Detail. And I think you know why I'm interested in what they're doing. We have with us Hill Goedhart, Frank Bausmith, and Pedro Echeverria. I said it right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
All right. Very good. Hill, you got the microphone here. Tell me a little bit about this group, what you guys do.
Yes, sir. We actually got assigned to the Parks Bureau about 4.5 years ago when we absorbed the county park system. And with that, we absorbed 177 county parks that we go out and patrol. We formed a full-time mounted unit, and with that, there's six of us that ride full-time. I have 23 that are assigned to the unit also.
Are you the boss?
I'm the team leader, so I'm not the
boss. That makes you the boss.
I'm in charge of these other two guys. That's the biggest thing that they understand, yeah. Yeah, so, and with that, we have 23 to 24 people that are assigned to us collaterally, and they come out when we need them to ride, but we also have them on a monthly basis for our med monthly trainings where we expose them to a bunch of different things.
Now, are those professionals or are those volunteers?
Those are all sworn also. So with those sworn, I have everything from an arson explosive detectives, homicide detectives, general patrol guys, custody people, court system, so it's a variety of a bunch of different people that actually come out.
So when you've got some sort of incident going on, do you pick and choose who comes out, or is it just whoever's available?
If
you need help.
Yeah, it depends on what the venue is and what we actually need and how many we need. So if it's a lot of people, you know, we're pretty choosy, especially if it's a like a larger event like the Cinco de Mayo or the Mexican Independence Day where there's 30, 40, 50,000 people out there. The Hard Fest, we worked that just, 4 months ago. And there was about 45, 50,000 people there. And so it depends on the caliber of the horse, the training of the horse. Some of them can just come out and just do general patrol in the parks with us. Mm-hmm. Some of them can do the full-blown riot and everything. So
it matters what the training of the horse is,
exactly.
As well as the officer, the human officer.
Exactly, and the level of training that the horse and the officer has, too, on horseback. So remember, this is our patrol car.
Now, this is enforcement. Let's hand the microphone over here to Frank for just a moment. Pedro, you're not going anywhere.
Good try.
He's took another step backwards when I said that. Okay, Frank, tell me a little bit about the horses. Are these private, personal horses that come in? Are they something that's owned by the county or what?
These are privately owned horses. We do our own training and facilitate that for the other members of our unit. And so we need to have battle-ready horses. These horses have to be conditioned and have the ability to go into extreme circumstances where they're getting things at times thrown at them. A lot of people around, sometimes hospital. Most of the time, people are pretty nice and friendly. Most of the people just want to come up and they want to pet on our horses, take cell pictures with us. The kids love the horses at whatever venue we're at. That's really what we really love. We do get called out to take care of business from time to time. And that's our specialty. And so in training these horses, we really prepare them for worst case scenario.
I know how long it takes me to get my horses caught up and loaded and off to go trail riding. How can you respond quickly enough to a situation?
Yeah, with our email system now, we can put out a call for service by our members who, like Hill said, are associate members of ours within our unit.
And are they on call? Do they just have their horses ready to go?
They do. And okay. Yeah, so we either email, reach them by cell phone, and then we have our gear all set up and ready for them to respond to whatever rigs we have stationed throughout the county so they can load up and roll to wherever we need them to.
What is the equipment that you guys use in addition to just the usual tack on a horse?
We actually carry a laptop on our saddlebags that we can run suspects on. We also are EMTs. All three of us are EMTs.
Yeah.
So we're part of the search and rescue team. And so we carry medical supplies and equipment on our vests and our saddlebags as well.
I never in a million years would have guessed you were going to say a computer. But it's kind of like when somebody pulls you over for driving a little fast. I mean, I've heard of that happening. It never happens to me. But they run your tags or whatever. They've got a computer right there in their patrol car.
Correct.
You basically got kind of the same thing on horseback.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's so funny. This is called enforcement. This is more than just, you know, being ambassadors. This is more than just being eyes and ears out there. Talk to me a little bit about what the enforcement side of it means. What do you have to be prepared to do?
We do exactly what a patrol car or a deputy in a patrol car will do. We can be assigned calls for service. We patrol the parks. We can go out 2-3 blocks in the inner city, the streets, and we basically look for crimes. Just like a deputy sheriff on a car or on a motorcycle, we do enforcement. Often, we arrest more than the average deputy because our height advantage.
You can see more going on.
Exactly. We can see more within the parks. Nighttime, we're very, very quiet, and we can actually approach people. By the time they realize who we are, even with our uniforms, it's too late. And they have this conception, and say, you know what, I better not run because they're going to catch me.
Yeah.
So enforcement is most probably 80%, 90% of our duties on a daily basis.
And you actually catch them and you arrest them in some cases?
Yes, sir. Yes, we do. And we do all the paperwork, and all we do is call a patrol car and they take them to jail.
I see. What kind of horses work best for this?
Any kind of horse. We have everything from Arabs to Aztecas to Spaniards to quarter horses to Shires to Percherons. So we're not so much looking at the breed. What we're looking at is the actual mentality or the calmness of the horse themselves, because we'll go from, like Frank was saying, we'll go from full-blown riot, you know, where we're pushing people and doing everything, but then 30 seconds later the horse has to sit there and just be nice and calm and just kind of hang out again. So a lot of it's just the disposition of the horse. A lot of our horses that's within our unit are quarter horses, so we use a lot of quarter horses.
Sure. So. Do you put them through special training to kind of get them ready for that kind of stuff?
Yeah, we have a monthly training that we put the horses, that we actually put our whole unit through. Yeah. The six of us are out training every single day because we're exposing our horses to everything. But everything from sensory to shooting off their back, shooting around them, the lights and siren, we'll have fire engines come in, we'll have the patrol cars come in, we have the helicopters that'll hover over the top of us because of the search and rescue.
Mm-hmm.
We actually have where there are people airlifted out, so the horses have got to be able to stand and stand quietly. We do a lot of different firecrackers, noisemakers, I mean, you name it, whatever we can think of, and especially with the six of us being out there full time, we'll see something that spooks the horses, and then we bring it to training. Well, we'll work on it, but then we bring it back to training for the other people because, you know, we're seeing firsthand what the horses are going to get exposed to, and so it helps the other guys when we do the monthly trainings with them too.
You are listening to members of the Mounted Enforcement Detail, the Parks Department of the L.A. County Sheriff's Department. When we get back, can they rope bad guys? I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the five very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. My guests are members of the Mounted Enforcement Detail, Parks Department, LA County Sheriffs. By parks, you mean like city parks or big parks?
It's both. It's both. So what we have is we have like Castaic. Castaic is a huge two different lakes, a bunch of different hills that we patrol around. But then it has all of the playground and it has all the different things there. But then we'll go into South Central LA, which is our South Zone. Areas that are high crime activity, a lot of the gangsters that'll live in the immediate area try to come into the parks and stuff too, and that's our job, is to basically saturate that and to keep them out. Like Pedro was saying, our main purpose is to go in there and to enforce any and all laws to keep those parks safe, so it makes it a nicer area for those people to come in. Huh. So like the South Central ones, when we first took it over, it was kind of, there was a lot of questionable people there. Now you go and it's all families, people are working out, people are running at nighttime, and it's a lot safer, and they like seeing the horses around. Kind of think of us as we're probably the closest thing to a fireman on horseback, because I've been on for 31 years. I never had anybody come up to my patrol car and want to pet it. Okay. But for my horse, they'll come up all day long. And I mean, we're constantly getting stopped in the park of people that want to stop and they want to talk. And it's also good for PR, because if there's something that happens in the park, most people will come up and approach you before they will somebody in the patrol car. And they'll tell you, hey, so-and-so over there, he's the one that kind of did it. So you might want to go over there and talk to them while they're petting your horse.
You know, I flashed when I was a kid. There was a motorcycle officer that sat right across the street from our house, and he was looking for speeders. And all of the kids in the neighborhood got to know him, and we would sit out there and talk to him, and he was still doing his job and all, but he was like officer friendly to us, you know, because he was accessible. He wasn't inside a vehicle, and I suspect there's some of that going on as well. Let's say worst case scenario, things kind of escalate and you have to do what you have to do. Do you carry weapons with you?
Yes. We, besides our normal duty weapons that we would carry, our gun belts with our guns and things, depending on what type of environment that we go in, we also have our ARs that we'll sling on, or our shotguns that we'll sling on. We have bokens, which is just a wooden stick that's on the side. It's a 40-inch horse baton that we use in case somebody tries to hurt our horses. We can actually keep them away. So
non-deadly.
Non-lethal type stuff. You know, we have our normal taser. We have the pepper spray. So we have everything that you would see within a radio car and what a actual patrol officer has. Our radio car is just our horses. That's it. There's nothing different with what we wear compared to what they wear, other than, you know, like I said, we have a radio car that's a horse.
When you get into, when you're off the beaten path there in one of these parks and so forth, and something is happening, you call for assistance? Is that correct? Or at least let people know that something's going on?
What happens is that for the most part, some of these city parks that you're talking about, the smaller ones, backup is readily available all the time. I mean, they can get there just as quick as they can because they have a radio car.
Because you're near a street, probably.
Right. For us, there's a lot of times where we'll be 3, 4, 5 miles off the beaten path. So the only backup we have is ourselves.
Wow.
And so we really have to trust each other, and we really need to be able to rely on each other in those circumstances, because backup could be, you know, 35, 40 minutes away, other than the helicopter coming above us. That's
it. Man. Frank, why is there still a need for mounted officers in modern times?
You know, I think it's not just the romance of the
It is pretty cool, and you've got a great mustache. It looks like Wyatt Earp. That's what he looks like.
You know, all of us we love the lifestyle, and mostly we love our horses, but to incorporate, you know, the thing that we love the best, and, you know, most of us have 30 years on the department, and so we're patrolmen, field training officers, ex-detectives ourselves, and we gave up those positions to pursue what we do now. And this is about as close to the 1850s as I'm going to get. But it's, you know what? It's a lot of the people that you meet. The parks are very, very diverse. The parks in LA County, they're beautiful. They have lakes. They're not just sand and swing sets. Mm-hmm. The vantage points over the LA Basin and the ocean in some parts of these parks are unbelievable. And I see a lot of people actually using the parks now to their full potential. Go in there to work out, and they enjoy the freedoms of not being subjected to a negative environment. The kinds of things that we don't really like to talk about, the things that we really don't like to be exposed to, but that's why we're there. And I know people feel comfortable with that.
Were you a horseman before you?
I was.
Got into this?
Yes. As I was assigned as a detective, I was one of the collaterally assigned people involved with the mounted enforcement detail. So I would get the phone call or the email to show up to a particular venue. And then a position opened up for myself, and I became full-time. So for me, it's just pure delight.
Oh, when you're a kid, you probably wanted to be a policeman or a cowboy, and now you get to be both.
Now I get both.
Pedro, a little bit about your background. How did you end up doing this?
When I was a child, I had a horse. I actually grew up in Ecuador.
Cool.
Yeah, we had a 2,000-acre ranch. 30-plus years later, you know, I had the need, you know, and the want to ride again, join the unit, not to do the two things that I truly love. It's law enforcement, not on horseback. And,
cool.
And I traded my, as a detective, my desk for a horse.
Oh, man. Perfect. Back to you, Hill. Did you hire these two guys?
Yes, okay. I'm kind of responsible for them.
Okay, so, well, you're the team leader, I know. What do you look for in somebody that wants to be a part of your team? Do you look for a seasoned law enforcement officer and then teach them the horse work, or would you rather have a good horseman and teach them law enforcement?
You know what? I need both.
Yeah.
Because the thing is that when they come in, that's right now is when we're working.
No time for on-the-job training.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, what do you ride?
I ride a couple quarter horses. I actually team rope and calf rope. So I use my roping horses.
Okay.
Because
have you ever roped a suspect?
You know, Rick, I would love...
Or can you tell me that?
I would love to have the department authorize us to do that. You know?
Okay.
But we're not allowed to do that.
Yeah,
we're not allowed to do that.
Okay, it was just a thought.
Yeah, I wish they would actually authorize that. But I keep trying, but it won't work.
Pedro, what do you ride?
I ride a quarter horse and Andalusian.
Okay, and what about you, Frank?
I have two quarter horses and a Mustang, BLM Mustang.
All right, good for you. Well, keep up the good work, guys. I mean, we really depend on you. I'm envious, to be honest. And I love the hats. You got these perfect matching black hats, except you're good guys. You should be. So you probably wear white hats in the summertime. All right. Well, my guests have been Hill Goedhart, Frank Bausmith, and Pedro Echeverria from the Parks Department of the LA County Sheriff's Department. This is the Mounted Enforcement Detail. Guys, thanks so much for being with us today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Natural light and ventilation make horse barns healthier places to be. So says my next guest, award-winning equine architect John Blackburn. There's a whole lot more of the horse show yet to come. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. Six panels make a 13-foot round pin. Eight panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD-TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD-TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD-TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
You know, I recently caught up with award-winning equine architect John Blackburn at River Farm Sport Horses, one of the facilities he's designed in historic Northern Virginia, to talk about his ideas on making stables and barns healthier. Well, let's start at the beginning, John.
All right.
How did you get to this point in your life? A little bit of your backstory.
A little bit of my backstory was a lot of luck and being at the right place at the right time. I grew up with horses. I had a twin sister who rode horses and competed somewhat. She wanted me to ride. I said, no, I wasn't interested. I would ride in across the fields and get on a horse with a halter or a lead rope or something, bare back and ride till I fell off. So I had no real interest. I didn't have the patience. So I played in the barn, and we had kept our horse in a neighbor's barn. So I played in the barn for years, and then she grew out of horses, went off to college. I got away from it and didn't really think twice about it. Then when I came and moved to Washington, D.C. out of graduate school, I came here interested in really in totally something different, like renovating buildings. Mm-hmm. I had a partner, we started our own business, additions and garage enclosures and things like that. We got a call that there was a horse farm to be built in Middleburg, which is just not far from here. And we had never done any horse, we had never done anything. But they wanted to interview, and we said, well, shoot, we'll interview, why not? what we got to lose.
Right.
But they considered other architects who'd done other things, but nobody had done a horse farm. My partner at that time was from Middleburg, and he understood the context, because we'd learned from the owner that he wanted buildings to fit into Middleburg, which has a very definite look, sort of an old style, colonial style, if you will. Federal style is the actual official term.
Sure.
And so we said, well, sure, we'll interview, but we didn't have anything to show for it. So what we did is we went out and we photographed hundreds of buildings in the Middleburg area, such as where we are now, which is not really Middleburg, but close by. It's Northern Virginia. And this is the old technology. In those days, you took slides, projected them on a wall, put tracing paper over that, sketched them, took that, put them on illustration board, rendered them, took that into show the owner. Mm-hmm. So if you want buildings to fit into Middleburg on your new horse farm, this is what they have to look like. These are the materials, these are the shapes, these are the forms. You were hired. He loved it.
But he was just looking at the outside, wasn't he?
He was just looking at the outside.
Not so much how they function.
Right. And then the function is something which we knew a little about, but not we weren't expert at it. But the landscape architect for that particular farm was Morgan Wheelock, who I owe my career to, because he, with the owner, basically hired us. I think he hired us because, one, they hired us because we hit the nail on the head with the context. Mm-hmm. And he had the ideas. He had the natural light, natural ventilation, designing for the health and safety of the horse. He had done a few thoroughbred farms, and he, at that time, this is in the early 80s, the thoroughbred foal was worth more than the barn. You did everything. It's still valuable, but mm-hmm. in those days, it was incredibly valuable. It was really a peak time, you might say, for thoroughbred racing and breeding and that sort of thing. And this was a breeding farm, a broodmare breeding farm. So took his thoughts of ideas of using natural light and natural ventilation, combined that with the contextual elements, which in this barn, by the way, is in the book. It's the first chapter in my book. We combined that, and it worked perfectly.
Hmm.
You'd go in that barn in August, dead of summer, no wind, and your hair would literally lift just from the natural ventilation created
wow.
in the barn by the placement of the barn and how we designed that barn using natural light and natural ventilation. And this barn that we're going to tour here is done in the same way. All my barns in my book follow that same theory. It's two theories I used, and that was really brought to me by Morgan Wheelock that we employed and employed, I think, very successfully. It's using the scientific principle of the Bernoulli principle, which is as air blows across the field or like in an airplane wing, mm-hmm. it goes across the wing, it creates lift by
right.
the shape of, and the placement of the wing in the wind, or in this case, the barn. And so the placement of the barn is critical because you look at the prevailing summer breeze. You're always, for horses, you're always more concerned, even in the north, you're concerned with cooling in the summer, not with winter, cold conditions in the winter. Though you do, it does affect the design of the barn and how you use it. It's very critical. Then the other is, that's the Bernoulli principle. Then the other is a chimney effect. How do you bring in, use natural light to do several things for you. It creates a healthier environment. I can go on and on about the healthy environment that's created by natural light.
Really?
It helps sterilize the barn. I mean, I'll give you a little example. You take the side of a barn where you have Dutch doors, where we put in Dutch
sure.
doors, two things. We do it architecturally for rhythm. It gives a nice break up of the building, a long building. But it's also a fire escape. If you want to get a horse out of a barn, it might be burning, which luckily, knock on wood, has not happened.
Well, there's some tradition there too, isn't it?
Yes, kind of it's very much a tradition.
They identify
but
a barn from
another
that.
Example is as that door is open in the summer, or even partially open in the winter, the sun moves across the sky, and that band of light across the floor of the stall helps purify that stall.
Really?
Dark, dank stalls is what creates odor, creates ammonia gases that are generated, and that if by just by the simple daylight going through the barn eliminates and reduces the risk or the creation of odor.
Now, did you find a niche? I mean, were you able to find all those years ago that this was something that hadn't been really provided out in the architectural field?
Yes, in a sense I did. I think I've since found that. At that time, I didn't know. But what I did, two things. I found that out, but I also found my passion. I love what I do.
I can tell you're passionate.
I love what I do, and it's just... And I've been asked, why do I travel all over the country and do all these all over the country in different places and have to travel? We are in Northern Virginia.
Yeah, horse country. Absolutely.
And why don't I just do it here? And I said, I would just go crazy because, I mean, here you're doing the same thing. I'm designing for the natural environment, whatever that natural environment is.
I saw in your book a map of the U.S. and the states in which you had projects were dark. The states where you hadn't yet done projects were light. I was stunned.
We're filling in those voids, by the way.
Big time. Even in Arizona, where I live, in the desert. And I guess that brings me to some of the considerations that the climate imposes upon the design of your facilities.
The climate is critical. And placement of the barn and how you do it is all critical. But the climate is critical because when we design barns, the barn that we design in Michigan would be very different than the barn we design in, say, South Texas or Florida, because the environment's different. You're still concerned for the health and safety of the horse. You still use the same Bernoulli and Chimney effect and those sort of elements and natural light, natural ventilation, in wherever you are. I designed a farm in Calgary. I still design it for ventilation in the dead of winter because you want to ventilate that barn, because horse carries gives off a tremendous amount of humidity, a lot of bacteria, and that, if you're in a contained area, it's like an incubator. You're going to create disease, bacteria, odor. You want to ventilate that barn. You want to control it, but you want to ventilate it year-round. I don't care how cold it is. Unless you're in somewhere in Siberia, you might want to be. Think about it. But we always want to ventilate that barn. You just want to control it. The reason being is a horse is really meant, designed to live in the wild.
That's
right. Designed to live outside. If that horse wants to get out of the sun, it'll run under a tree. If it wants to get out of the wind, it'll run behind a hill. It doesn't go from 40 degrees to 70 degree temperatures. It goes from maybe 8 or 10 degree temperature difference. So when you're designing a barn, you want those temperatures to be roughly the same, especially if your horse is going in and out. Now, if you have a horse that has a show coat and something like that, and you want to protect it, you're going to use blankets. You want to keep it out of a draft. So what I try to do in designing a barn is I want to ventilate it, but I don't want to put the horse necessarily in a draft all year long.
Now, what happens if the owner comes to you and says, yeah, that's all good, but I really want to see it this way from my house or whatever, where there's kind of aesthetic considerations that the owner imposes upon you?
That's where we come in. And that's the fun part. There's three things I describe as critical for the success of any equestrian project. You've got the demands of the site, the placement of the site, where it's located, just as it's describing, the south, the north, hot, cold, whatever. You've got the goals of the owner, his architectural, his or her architectural style, the location, budget, all that plays into it. And then the final one, which is the most important, though all three have to be cared for, is the health and safety of the horse. That is the priority. I've walked away from two projects in my life where the health and safety of the horse was not paramount. And I said, you know, it's not worth it.
How do you bring the owner around if they're just not seeing that?
That was maybe a problem in my early years of doing this, but now that my reputation...
You're the expert. They bring you in because you've got the expertise.
I refuse to call myself an expert, but I like
to do
what I do, and I've done it for a lot of time, a lot of years. People know me, and they come to me because they're drawn to healthy barns. They've spent a lot of money on their horses, and they want to protect those horses.
I'm talking with John Blackburn, award-winning equine architect and author of Healthy Stables by Design. When we get back, I'll ask him why even bother putting horses in barns. I mean, they are meant to be outside. We'll see what he says.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit truevalue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit truevalue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage Jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you. Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
And direct them to our website, if you don't mind, thehorseshow.com. My guest is award-winning equine architect John Blackburn, talking about his book, Healthy Stables by Design. John, why do people think they need a barn?
Well, here's the reason. There are four reasons. You got the value of the horse, what you paid for the horse. Then there's the training of the horse and yourself for that horse. So you got a value built into that horse. Now, you not only the value you purchased it, but the value of training. Then you got the farrier, the vet, the feed, and all that sort of caring for the horse. There's an investment you have in the horse.
Ongoing.
So there's three of them. Those are important reasons to protect that horse. But the fourth one can quite possibly be the most valuable one, the emotional value. That is the most important one. And that's why people come to me. If they don't have that, they may go to just a prefab barn. They may just put it in any old barn because they want to get it out of the weather and protect it, but they don't really care that much. But it's that emotional factor. It's a pet. It's an investment. It's a very important part of your life. Mm-hmm. So you want to protect that investment. And that's why we do what we do.
What is the biggest site-related challenge that you run into?
Well, I think natural ventilation is the most important thing. You can add to it in different ways, of course, mechanically, but I try to do it naturally. And I tend to locate the barn perpendicular to the prevailing summer breeze in that location. And sometimes the contouring and the location of the land of the type may not work very well, so you do the best you can, and particularly if it's an existing barn. Mm-hmm. But we work with that as best we can to encourage natural ventilation. I was explaining a minute ago, and I want to go back to it, of why you want to ventilate the barn, but you want to keep the horse control the draft. For example, I mentioned the Dutch doors. You want to be able to close those Dutch doors in the winter, but you want the air to come in above the horse and go up, because that's now working with the chimney effect. That's pulling the air.
Sucking out the bad air.
But the horse is not in a draft.
Yeah.
Just like if it ran behind the hill out in the pasture. It's now out of the draft in a sense. So when you bring that horse in the barn, you're now taking the freedom away from the horse, but you've got to give it the freedom of that choice. In a sense, you're playing God. You've now got to control that horse's environment.
Speaking of giving horses choice, do you ever design stalls that have kind of an indoor-outdoor option so the horse can go outside?
Yes. In the early days when I was doing this with thoroughbreds, that wasn't as important. But with people and their, as I said, their emotional value, their care about their horse, they want to be, and also, it's not only that, they want the horse to go in and out.
More exercise.
They can see each other. It's a herd animal. They need to know what's around them. And they can go out and look, and that's why we put yoke gates in a lot of the stalls. But only if the owner requires them. And so it's the socialization of the horse that's also critical, not just its environmental health.
Sustainability is one of the words that keeps coming up.
Right.
Talk a little bit about your responsibility to the environment, how that plays in, and also I'm thinking we're right here by the Potomac River. How do you manage runoff?
Well, there's a variety of things that we do. I design and have, since my beginning, designed for natural light and natural ventilation. Well, that in itself is one of your first green factors. You want to use natural light, use natural ventilation. Do not depend on man-made ventilation such as fans. Mm. Though we put fans in our building, we do it in our stalls. We put it there so the horse can have a matter of choice. It's not being forced into a draft, but it has, if it wants wind, again, it's in a stall, it can get in and out of the wind. But the idea was using natural light and natural ventilation. My barns, almost to a case, are all naturally lit. You can work the barn, you can work this, the arena. We're in the arena right now. You can work it all day long without using man-made lights. You really don't need fans. This arena doesn't have any fans. Some have fans. The barn has some fans, but they rarely use them. You don't need them. So I found I was doing green barns long before it became fashionable. And I've described it, I've been designing green barns back when green was just a color.
And when back before it was cool.
Right, and in the late 90s, architects were getting all hyped up with green technology and designing buildings. And I sort of thought, well, heck, I'm doing it. I've been doing this for 20 years.
Yeah.
So I started calling it, and I also found that a number of my clients were coming to me asking for green technology. They wanted to put it into their barns. Even some of the most wealthy clients. I even had a client in Texas who was sitting on one of the largest natural gas reserves in the country. Mm-hmm. And he was getting natural gas but he wanted to put up windmills to generate all his power. That farm did not go forward, but I was amazed, and it showed me that even people with money and access to energy were wanting to go to green design principles.
Yeah.
So I really started promoting it and in articles that we are a sustainable, we follow sustainable design principles. And you mentioned about storm runoff. We try to recycle that, keep that on the site. We will use gray water collection in some cases, but many people don't really need to do that. They want to, but we don't want to run it off into the streams and pollute. It's different in different jurisdictions. I mean, you can be in Colorado or some places very dry, and they don't want you to necessarily contain it on your site. They want you to let it run off, not pollution runoff, but they want it to get back into the groundwater. And that's what we try to do whenever we can, is keep it on site, get into the groundwater.
Do you have to be aware of how deep the groundwater is where you
get civil engineers.
Make sure it doesn't seep into the groundwater?
Yeah, in an environmentally friendly way.
Yeah.
And basically, it's biostorm retention ponds. You basically allow it to seep back into the ground. And we use civil engineers, and generally locally, wherever we're working, we get a local civil engineer who is aware of that. Most of them are these days, and jurisdictions are different in how they allow you to do it. So we respond to the requirements of that location. Once again, that's the demands of the site, and then the needs of the site. For example, and the farm we would design in Arizona would be very different than what we might design in, I'll choose a wet area that's right now. There are wet areas in terms of groundwater, and there's wet areas because of rain. Mm-hmm. But so we do it differently depending on the location.
Right.
That first farm I described to you in Heronwood Farm, which is in Northern Virginia, we designed that without reservoirs or mini storm. This is back in 1983. Mm-hmm. We had a drought at one point during the life of that farm when the owner was on the farm, and he started building reservoirs, and he said, if it falls on this farm, I'm keeping it on this farm. Because he didn't want to have his pastures turning brown, his horses running out of water or anything. So we basically built reservoirs and stored water on the farm.
You know, what I see too in looking through your book here is a sense of style with regard to the choice of materials that you use and the colors that you use.
Right.
And I'm sure those things have a bearing on the way light is reflected inside a space as well. What can you tell us about choice of materials and colors?
Well, on the inside, I would tend to use reflective colors, certainly high up. Now you're down next on the stall walls, you wouldn't make those white necessarily, but you can certainly above it use as much natural light reflectance in the colors for natural light. For the reflectance of natural light as much as you can.
And in the lower parts, though, you have some very rich wood colors, and they're much darker.
Right, and that helps when you do get, you know, horse manure or whatever, the filth is around the barn, and you hope you keep it clean, but you don't have those staining the walls.
Kind of a practical consideration.
Yeah, it's a practical consideration. Yeah. Yeah. So once again, the barn is not only designed for the health and safety of the horse, but it's designed for functionality, the operation of the farm. You can spend a lot of money on a farm, just operating it. And how you lay out the farm, how you design the barn, the services, where they are located, and how they're accessed is very important.
Well, I know your book here, Healthy Stables by Design, shows a number of your projects. And we happen to be at, I don't know if it's your favorite one, I don't know if you have a favorite one, but here at River Farm.
It is a favorite, but it's not the favorite. They're all favorite.
Very well spoken.
I don't have a single favorite.
Well spoken. Here in historic Northern Virginia.
Right.
Okay. And right on the banks of the Potomac River. Will you show us around and kind of point out some of the things that we've been talking about as they've been applied here?
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
All right. And if you would like to see some of those barn designs, check out the TV show we did with John. Just go to YouTube and search on Rick Lamb and Healthy Stables. It's Forage First Nutrition, brought to you by ADM Alliance Nutrition. I am Rick Lamb, along with equine specialist Pat Cassidy. Pat, what nutrient sources for horses are the most calorie dense and the least calorie dense?
Well, the most calorie dense are the fats. Fats have 2.25 more times the energy or calories as any other thing we feed them. Calorie is just a measure of energy. If you don't burn them, they're going to start adding weight to the horse. The advantage there is you can use some fat in the diet if you need to put some weight on a horse. It allows you to feed a smaller portion and at the same time put more calories in him and not stress the system that way. Now, we're not talking about saturated fats here. We're talking about really nice natural plant fats like stabilized rice bran and omega flax.
Good fats.
Good fats. Shelf life was the limiting factor that kept us from feeding fats for a long time because, you know, fat wants to go rancid. We finally were able to come up with some fat sources that have integrity. Fats have come a long way and they've changed how horses are fed today. Now, the part of the diet that's got the least amount of calories is the forage. Let's say you had a pretty easy keeper that you were always kind of struggling with keeping the weight off them. A nice medium quality grass hay and a vitamin mineral supplement might satisfy everybody, might give him lots of chew time, keep him in better shape, and you're not going to make him obese. A lot of times you'll see a situation where other horses are getting to eat a concentrate, and here's this one horse that he doesn't get anything but hay, and people want to feed their horse something. So a vitamin mineral supplement in a kind of a low calorie base, our Stay Strong is a good example of that. Here's a way to feed him a feeding along with those other horses. You're not putting him at risk.
To learn more about ADM Alliance Nutrition, visit growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com.
And there you have it, my friends. Special thanks to my guests today, members of the Mounted Enforcement Detail, Parks Department, LA County Sheriffs, and also Mr. John Blackburn and his lovely assistant, Nola. The website, if you're interested in John's book, is just the title of the book, HealthyStablesByDesign.com. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.